Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I say Shabbat Shalom. I hope you're having a blessed and peaceful Sabbath day. Now, today's lesson is titled Compromising Faith, and we're going to look at it through Egypt in the eyes of Abraham and Lot, or for our purposes, through the world, you and your children. See, the deal is, we can all claim to have an unshakable faith, but the question is, what will you do in a crisis? Will you trust in the Almighty and His Word? Will you forsake your faith altogether? Or will you compromise your faith to reach the objective that you're seeking or desiring? See, in a crisis, we can rationalize ourselves right into compromising the very faith that we claim to have. And all this would do is ultimately lead us into a world of problems and all sorts of issues. So, we're going to find out what happened to Abraham, the father of many nations, and some of the problems that he had because of compromising his faith. Keep in mind, we must at all costs refrain from using our own biased judgment when it comes to the Father's word and doing exactly what He has told us to do. We must do exactly what He instructs us to do so that we won't have any problems. Even in the face of adversity, we must be patient. James 1:4 tells us to let patience have her perfect work. And this is because the work and effect of afflictions is the perfecting of us in the Almighty. We always have to count it joy when we are being tried in the fire because of these afflictions. This is what proves us. This is what grows our faith. This is what refines us. Here we see that the Almighty has forgiven Abraham of his transgressions and has not remembered them against him. Why? If we remember, Acts 3:19 reads like this, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of the refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." And this is what Abraham did. He repented of his transgressions and the Father forgave him, as He will any of us, and He will not remember our sins against us if we repent and turn away from them and not repeat them over and over. So we're going to see how Abraham did this and compare some of the parallels of his life to ours, because it's pretty much the same journey. Now go with me to Genesis 12:1. Genesis 12:1 reads, "Now the Lord has said to Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land I will show thee." So Abraham did this and stepped out on faith, so much so that he didn't even know where he was going. Now, mind you, this was a real test of blind faith for a man like Abraham. Not only did he not know where he was going, he was coming from an idolatrous pagan lifestyle that he had lived for 75 years. Some of us won't even live 75 years, but yet we won't come away or let go some of the things that we're holding on to. And here this man is at 75 years old being told to step out on faith, and he did so. But mind you, he did have some problems because ultimately he didn't let everything go. Go with me to verses 4 and 5, and they read, "So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. So Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their substance that they had gathered, and the souls they had gotten in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan. And into the land of Canaan they came." Now, the word tells us that Abraham listened to what the Almighty had told him to do, but at the same time, he compromised the directions given him. Just like many of us, when we're directed to do a particular thing, we compromise. He told Abraham to get out of the country and from thy kindred, but what did he do? He told him to get up, get out, and leave your relatives behind. But Abraham inserted his own thinking into what the Father had told him to do, and some of his own thoughts into the Father's equation, and he took Lot, his nephew, with him, and hundreds of others out of Haran with him. Don't believe me? Go with me to Genesis 14:14. And it reads, "And when Abraham heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants born in his own house, 318, and pursued them unto Dan." Now, these were the servants that he brought with him because his brother was kidnapped later on, or taken captive later on. Now, think about this. These 318 servants of his own house that went with him to rescue his brother, those were just the males. So how many more in total? So there were several hundreds of them that he took out of Haran with them, because they took women and children also. It weren't just men who went. See, either you should be getting up, leaving Haran to the land that the Father will show you, or you should be clearing the land that the Father has already given you of the things and people that cause you to compromise your faith and prevent your promised land from bearing fruit. This is why some of us aren't doing or being as fruitful as we should be where we are, because we stay where we shouldn't stay, or we should have gotten up and moved on a long time ago. So we have to really pay attention to what the Father is telling us when he's telling us, and quit hanging on to these things that are holding us down. See, many of you are choosing to carry the excess baggage of others and things around with you and claim it as your own. You've claimed their mess, their baggage, their everything as your own, and so it's yours. The negative people and things in your life is not their fault, it's your fault, because you took ownership of it, and no one's responsible for your happiness except you. So if you want to become happier and you want your land to be fruitful, you're gonna have to clean up some of these things. You can't sit around being miserable, sad, depressed, unhappy, angry, upset, blah, 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 blah about what you're allowing. You have to change it. Abraham did just like you. He claimed baggage of others and brought baggage with him that he shouldn't have brought, and he compromised along the way. We have to understand that with Abraham, as the same with us, that these are willful and sinful compromises, because they cause us to misplace our confidence in things and people of the world, and to mistrust and misconstrue what the Father has told us to do and his very word. And we have to come away from that. Go with me to Isaiah 31:1. Isaiah 31:1 reads, it says, "Woe, woe, woe to them that go down to Egypt for help, and stay on horses and trust chariots, because there are many, and in horsemen, because they are very strong, but they look not unto the Holy One of Israel, neither seek the Lord." And it has an exclamation point at it. So this is being yelled at us. It's being screamed at us. This is very serious. Remember, I previously told you in the teaching that woe is a warning. Woe is a warning. Understand, it is a very powerful warning. That means that if it's not adhered to, it will most certainly bring grave consequences. Abraham left Haran, and what did he do? He brought some issues with him. And along the way, there was a famine in the land. Now, here's a parallel for some of you and some of the problems that are going on in your life. You're carrying around the compromising baggage of others with you, and you're running into problems left and right, or shall we say a famine in your land. Now, this is the point where you begin to compromise your faith and trust in the Father to survive your own famine or your own problems in your life. Go with me to Genesis 12:10. It reads, "And there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was grievous in the land." It's no different than you having problems, major or otherwise, in your life. You're going to come up against these problems because of something we've allowed. Remember, this is where the woe in Isaiah 31:1 kicks in, because the Father further explains in Isaiah 30 that you are doing this of your own accord. Go with me to Isaiah 30, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 3. "Woe to the rebellious children, saith the Lord." See, he's specifically telling us now. "That take counsel, but not of me." That take counsel, but not of me. Who are you listening to? You're compromising in your own mind. You're listening to yourself. You're scheming and plotting and planning in your own thinking. See, you're not taking counsel of him anymore. You're doing it on your own. "And that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin. So the Father's clear. He says, you're not doing this of his counsel, you're doing it of your own or somebody else or whoever. And now you're going to create more sin to this sin of disobedience. You're being disobedient now. Verse 2, that walked down into Egypt and have not asked at my mouth to strengthen themselves in the strength of Pharaoh and to trust in the shadow of Egypt. See, he's being real clear. He's saying, you're not doing this of him, and then you're compromising. You're going to go down to Egypt, or for you all, you're going to go out here into the world and put your trust in them to gather the strength through the world by whatever means to survive the famine. Verse 3, therefore shall the strength of Pharaoh be your shame, and the trust in the shadow of Egypt be your confusion. Do y'all understand what that is saying about us? When we take our trust from him and put it in another direction which he didn't steer us to, when we compromise what he said and go off on our own, we're going to have some issues. Look, when you don't do what he has instructed explicitly and start to rationalize and add your own judgment to it, you are not trusting that he will get you through as he has promised. If he sends you in a direction, you have to trust that he's going to get you through. He's not going to send you somewhere where you can't get through with his help if need be. See, you're lacking faith and you are being disobedient. That's why he tells us that Egypt is going to be our very confusion. The world is going to be your confusion when you don't listen to what he tells you. He said that Abraham was doing this on his own and may add more sin to sin, just like us, which he did, and he added more. All sorts of problems ultimately follow. Now, your parallel in life is this: carrying around others and their baggage of compromise as your own is not of the Father's instruction to you. And woe to you when you seek worldly resolution to the problems that are going to follow you because of your famines or because of your problems. See, in your attempt to resolve your own issues through man without the Father's guidance, it becomes a challenge because now you're in a confused state of faith because of your weakened condition. And that thinking and rationalizing of the Father's instruction has caused this confusion. Like verse 3 just said, Egypt or the world is your confusion. See, famine was a test of Abraham's faith, just like problems are a test of our faith. Same thing. His famine was different from ours. His was a literal famine. But some of us may go through a literal famine too. Understand, people, that a faith that can't be tested can't be trusted. So we are going to be tested. 1 Peter 1:7 speaks about this. Go with me there. It reads, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than that of gold that perish, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So we're simply told that we're going to be put through the fire to see if all that junk or dross can be removed from us so that we're all pretty and shiny and presentable at the appearing of our Savior. See, we have to go through this. We have to be purified. Abraham brought certain drama of others with him, just like many of you have drama of others in your home, on your job, and in your life. Well, just know you're going to be called out on it and tested since you're choosing to have these things or these people in your life. The Father is merely giving you an opportunity to be tried in the fire so that all this junk is removed so that you can appear presentable when the time comes. See, the Father didn't send Abraham to Egypt. He chose to go there and put his trust in man. The Father had commanded them never to return to Egypt. Deuteronomy 17:16 and 28:68. And the reason is because he didn't want them to forget the benefit of the redemption they have received from being removed from Egypt in the first place. And secondly, he didn't want them to be corrupted with the superstition and idolatrous ways of the Egyptians all over again. And do what? End up forsaking him again. Jeremiah 2:18. Go read them. Now, the Father wants us to stay out of the ways of the world, same thing, so that we are corrupted over and over again and end up forsaking Him. Because that's what happens when we get caught up in the world, we forsake the Father. We choose it of our own. We have to be very much aware of what we are doing. The Father can't save us from ourselves. We have to choose to be saved. Now, let's talk about the children for a moment, since we understand that when we dip down in Egypt, it corrupts us. What do we think it's doing to our children? So, answer this question. Where do they learn their love of the world and sin from? They don't learn it from the world. They learn it from us, because we present them to the world. See, we have to learn how to keep them away from the world. See, when you compromise your faith, or at least the one you claim to have, and don't come all the way out of Egypt or all the way out of the world, you're hanging on to some of those idolatrous ways, some of those habits, some of those things you love so much, some of those tastes you love so much, some of those desires. Understand that your children are acquiring the very same things that you haven't forsaken, because they see everything, whether you realize it or not. So don't fool yourself. And as they see it, they are learning it. It's all going in up there, irregardless of what you think you're teaching them. So while you're camping out in the world, your children are becoming more worldly. But as you are raising them to be godly, they are thinking what? Of the world. So when it's time for them to depart from you, more often than not, eventually they're going to choose the world, because that's what they have tasted through you. That's what you have taught them, because you never came out of the world. You dibbled and dabbed and all that, and you had a weakened testimony that you tried to present to your children. Pay attention to Lot's situation. This is why he chose to go and put his tent up near Sodom, because when Abraham took him out of Haran and the famine hit, they went to Egypt. So what did he do? He showed Lot this world of Egypt. And many of you are doing the same thing to your children. Understand, your children sample all these negative and worldly things that you experience through you. So don't expect that they won't desire it as they grow. They will. See, you may survive the world and the safety in the Father because you're on this path now, but that's not what you're planting in your children so much. They may not survive the worldliness that you're putting into them because you're still in confusion with your face and still sampling and dibbling and dabbling in the world. You are corrupting your children. Genesis 13:10 reads like this. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, thou comest unto Zoar. See, when they finally left Egypt and then they came into the land of Sodom and Gomorrah, what did Lot do? He said, oh my goodness, this reminds me of Egypt. This is where I want to stay. See, he still had Egypt in his heart. That's why he went into the land of Sodom and Gomorrah. See, because he got a taste of it through his uncle Abraham in Egypt. And Abraham took him there. See, so if you backtrack and see all the wrong things, see, Abraham wasn't even supposed to go to Egypt. He wasn't even supposed to bring a Lot out of Haran. But see what he did to Lot? A weakened testimony. Some of you are doing this to your own children. You're in the world, but you're trying to show them something else. But this is the same thing that's going to happen. When it's time for some of your children to depart home, many of them are going to walk out the door on their way to college, military, marriage, ill-advised relationships, shacking up, hanging out, doing whatever it is they do. But they're going to walk out the door and the world's going to hit them in the face, and it's all going to come back to memory. All those negative and sinful and worldly things that they sampled through you. And they're going to say, oh my goodness, this is just like when I was at home. I remember this and I remember that. And now they're out on their own. And now you're going to find yourself going through their trials and their pains and their suffering. This is why it happens, because when we aren't right in raising these children, We can't raise them right. We can front and pretend that we're teaching them all righteousness, and they're looking at all the negative, all the wrong, all the worldly things you do, all the desirous things of the world. This is what they really hang on to. Some of them will be confused because they know right from wrong. See, they know both sides of the fence. But what's going to rule? The flesh. The flesh is going to rule. And they're going to succumb to so much of that craziness. And the sad thing is, many of them, as they approach the world with that same zeal and excitement of being at home in your care, the world's going to devour them. Because the world is Egypt. And they have sampled Egypt. And all that's going to come back to them when they see it. And now they have no reins on them. They are free to do what they want. So you have to choose to do right, to raise your kids right. They don't see any in-between as you try and teach them one thing and do another. They ultimately see what the flesh and its desires teaches them, the world. So don't compromise your faith and go into Egypt and become corrupted and corrupt others along the way. Don't carry others and their baggage if your journey is meant for you and you alone. Leave them and their baggage behind and move forward. Leave your home and go to a place where the Father will show you. Or rid your promised land that you already have of all the idolatry, all the wickedness, all the worldly things. Clean house and get back on board so that the Father can guide you spiritually throughout the rest of your days, so that you may be presentable in the time of the refreshing. And with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.